And so you'll be able to catch that. Just hit it. Do not pay YouTube to be on YouTube. Do not pay Facebook to be on Facebook. They are free. So if you can't get to the place where you understand YouTube, ask someone, ask the grandchild, ask the niece and nephew. They're very good at knowing what to do to get you on there. So that there's so many things that you can explore. If you like recipes, get on YouTube. If you like home decorating, get on YouTube. If you got to fix your refrigerator and you ain't got nobody around the house, get on YouTube. YouTube has everything. So we're going to go forth with the Exodus series, and we're going to be part four. And then I'm going to entitle this No Child Left Behind. No Child Left Behind. We are in Exodus chapter 12, and I'm going to read to you from Exodus chapter 12, verse 23 through 41. For the Lord will pass through and smite the Egyptians. Last week's lesson was, it's under the blood. It's under the blood. You gotta watch that. And when he sees the blood upon the lintel and on the two side posts, the Lord will pass over the door and will not suffer the destroyer to come in unto your houses to smite you. Some of you, if it had not been for the blood, hallelujah, that you pleaded over your mantle, it would have been worse than you thought it was. And you shall observe this thing for an ordinance to thee and thy sons forever, and it shall come to pass when you become to the land which the Lord will give you according to he hath promised, that you shall keep this service. We're talking about the Passover service. That ye shall say, it is a sacrifice of the Lord's Passover, who passed over the houses of children of Israel in Egypt when he smote the Egyptians and delivered our houses, and the people bowed the head and worship. Listen, stop letting people tell you that we've heard that testimony over and over again. You better keep giving your testimony right here in the word. It said, tell generations and generations how he bought you over, how he bought you through. You might not have had to go through a Red Sea. You might not have had the 10 plagues, but we lived through pandemic. Yes, we did. So you have a testimony, and yeah. You don't let anybody keep you from giving your testimony. I don't care if you got to give the same one every Sunday, every week, whatever. You better testify, because we are overcomers by the blood and the word of our testimony. That's what the Bible says. So back to the scripture, 26. It shall come to pass when your children shall say unto you, what mean you by this service? Why are we doing this? Why we keep going to church and taking communion and celebrating Passover? That you shall say, it is the sacrifice of the Lord's Passover, who passed over the houses of the children of Israel in Egypt when he smote the Egyptians and delivered our houses, and the people bowed their heads and worshiped. They bowed their head and worshiped. We don't know when to worship. I'm telling you, when he done brought you through something, you better get on your face and give God the glory. Just tell him all about how you feel about him. Be thankful. Hallelujah. Sometimes God brings us through stuff and we forget to say thank you. But we need to go back to the old landmark where they got on their faces, bowed their faces before the Lord and worshiped. And the children of Israel went away and did as the Lord commanded Moses and Aaron. So did they. And it came to pass that at midnight, remember, they had girded up their loins. They were instructed to eat with their shoes on instead of off, which was customary. They were told to eat everything that was there. They were told to get a lamb. And there was, if you couldn't afford a lamb, get a bird, a turtle, something. Get something. And, oh, my God, I don't know why I'm stuck here. Get something. If you don't have, I don't have that to put in. They're asking me to give this, and they're asking me to give that. Listen, give what you got. It's all about how you give it. You give thanks with a grateful heart, with a grateful heart. God loves a cheerful giver. You may not have what Sister Soja and Brother New Who has down the street, but you got what you got because God gave it to you. And so you got to learn how to just be able to give what you got. And so they ate what they had, what they had, and everybody ate it, from the children to grandma and grandpa to great grandma and great grandpa. Everybody stood. They had to stand to eat, because any minute I'm out of here. And I'm, listen, that's what I talk about. Any minute, y'all better watch me. Watch my smoke, because I'm out of here. Somebody used to tell me in church, when I was going to Metropolitan, they would say, we didn't see you. You moved over to the other side. I said, that's right. You gotta stick and move all the time, because the enemy tries to track you. He knows your habits and all that. Every now and then, you need to change up your route. And so they put the blood on the door and delivered them by their houses. And it came to pass at midnight, the darkest hour right before the day, the Lord smote all the firstborn in the land of Egypt, from the firstborn of Pharaoh that sat on his throne unto the firstborn of the captive that was in the dungeon, and all the firstborn of cattle. God was not playing. And Pharaoh rose up in the night, he and all his servants and the Egyptians, and there was a great cry in Egypt. Let me tell you, everybody was weeping. Everybody was crying, for there was not a house where there was not one dead. And he called for Moses and Aaron by night and said, rise up and get you forth from among my people. Get out of here, both you and the children of Israel, and go serve the Lord like you said. I also take your flocks, take your herds, as you have said, and be gone, and bless me also. And the Egyptians were urgent upon the people that they might send them out of the land in haste, for they said, we be all dead men. And the people took their dough before it was leavened, their kneading troughs being bound up in their clothes upon their shoulders. The children of Israel did according to the word of Moses, and they borrowed of the Egyptians jewels of silver, jewels of gold, raiment. And the Lord gave the people favor in the sight of the Egyptians, so they lent unto them such things as they required, and they spoiled the Egyptians. And the children of Israel journeyed from Ramses to Succoth, about 600,000 on foot, that were men besides children. And a mixed multitude went also with them, in flocks and herds, even very much cattle. And they baked unleavened cakes of the dough which they brought out of Egypt, for it is not leavened. Because they were thrust out of Egypt and could not tarry, neither had they prepared for themselves any victuals. Now the sojourning of the children of Israel who dwelt in Egypt was 430 years. And it came to pass at the end of the 430 years, even the selfsame day, it came to pass that all the host of the Lord went out from the land of Egypt. May the Lord add a blessing to the reading of that word. Make sure you pick up your word and just study through it. You want some excitement? Read in the Old Testament some of those testimonies. But Lord God, we ask that you bless it. Lord God, we ask that you sanctify this time, oh God, that you help us to consecrate and concentrate. Lord God, that we fix our hearts on you, that we fix our eyes and our ears, Lord God, on the Holy Spirit. Lord God, help us to hear what we need to hear for this season, oh God. And we promise at the end of that story, we'll give you all the glory in Jesus' name. Amen. So we're in Exodus chapter 12, and there's no child left behind. We are in our, I believe it's our fourth week. It could be fifth week. And I hope that you're not tired of hearing about them little rebellious children of Israel. Because we're struggling in areas where we need deliverance also. We're just like them. I don't care. We may dress different. We may wear our hair different. Our culture is a little different. But we are, in a lot of ways, we're just like them, children of Israel. We're struggling in areas where we need deliverance, whether it's from our old habits and addictions, to past hurts, to financial bondage, spiritual and emotional bondage. We've talked about these deliverance in the very beginning. Make sure you go back and listen to the breakthrough. Deliverance is always referred to when people are talking about or being held certain situations that they need brought out of. I don't know what you need delivered from. I don't know what you're struggling with. I don't know what got you bound. I don't know what stopped your praise. I don't know what stopped your dance. I don't know what stopped your song. I don't know what cut out your smile. I don't know what happened. Something happened and you can't break free from it. And every day you wake up, I'm going to be better. I'm going to do this better. And then there's a reminder of something that causes you to catapult all the way right back to where you started. But I'm trying to get past that. But deliverance is taking oneself from one arena and delivering it into another arena. Just like you deliver mail, we take the mail comes from, say, California, it goes through all these routes and all these things, and it gets to the post office in your hometown, in your city, and then it's not considered delivered. It will say in process, in progress, this is where it's at, in transit. It'll say in transit, but when it gets to your home address, it will say what? Delivered. Hallelujah. I can't wait to get that note from the Lord saying, no, Frida, you are definitely delivered. Deliverance is even referred to when it comes to someone being possessed by an evil spirit. And this person is being controlled by something or someone. Hey, sometimes it's not a sickness. Sometimes it's not, that's just who they are. Sometimes people got a spirit on them, and that spirit needs to be rebuked. It needs to be delivered out of them in the name of Jesus. This person's being controlled by something or someone that has been possessed by an evil spirit. Again, they need to be set free. They do. And we as the body of Christ need to be able to tell these spirits, be able to discern these spirits. Like, is that a spirit or is that just, they're just nasty? No, they got a spirit that's been passed down from generation to generation. And you may be thinking about this afternoon that you don't allow anything to control you. But I'm here to tell you that when you eat and you're not hungry, but you just got to have it, boom. Huh, that's control. When you find yourself continuously going to the corner store to buy cigarettes that cost over $5, $6, even though on the side of the package, it tells you right on the side of the package, it causes cancer and that's not, and it'll go emphysema and whatever. That's control. When we can't say no to that thing. When you can't fix your mouth to stop lying or cussing, when you can't keep your personal parts in your panties or your skirts, when your hand shakes because you need a drink, when you can't stop gossiping or you just can't stand to go a week without one of the soap operas. And now it's not the afternoon soap operas like it used to be, the Young and the Restless, the Bold and the Beautiful. Now it's on the evening. It's the Oval and all of those things, the Oval Office and all that kind of stuff that Tyler Perry got going on. But nevertheless, we got to be there on Tuesday night, Wednesday night. Oh, they better get done with Bible study by this time because I got to watch my story. Y'all know about the stories. Uh-huh. We're like puppets that sometimes being manipulated and even controlled by other people. Yes, we are. But Pastor Frida, what are you saying? I'm saved. I'm filled with the Holy Ghost. And that's true. You are saved. And you, in our flesh, though, the Bible talks about our flesh dwells no good thing. It says that. And if we walk in the flesh, we're going to do the very fleshly things that we didn't want to do in the first place. We need delivered. Our bodies, our souls, our flesh needs deliverance. Bondage makes your head hang down. Mm-hmm. Some of you can't even, you're not even proud of who you are because of something that has you bondage. Everybody else could tell you you're beautiful and you think you're ugly. Everybody else can tell you you're the perfect size and you say, no, I'm too fat. I'm too skinny. I'm too, somebody tells you you got a nice dress on, but you, oh, I just got this from the Goodwill. You don't have to tell anybody that. You just say thank you and keep on stepping. But we have such a poor self-esteem. Our head hangs down. You can't walk right while you're in bondage. You can't talk right when you're in bondage. Sometimes you got to listen. I used to work in an institution, and we used metal shackles. And my people I took care of, sometimes even when they had schizophrenic episodes or whatever, we would bring other types of shackles. We had all kinds of different shackles for different purposes, and the enemy has the same one, y'all. I'm gonna put a period there. The enemy has different shackles that he ties you with. But the people I took care of, they would sometimes have to be in 4-point restraints, 4-point shackles. Or when they were going to like a medical hospital, we had to escort them and shackle them 4 points. The 4 points was the two hands, and the other was the ankles. And we, you know, we weren't allowed to unshackle them unless, you know, we were ready to do a particular a procedure that had to, that didn't coordinate with the shackles. But one of the rules was we could not shackle their hands behind their back. I know that's what the police do, but because we were in such an institution as it was, somebody cared, because you weren't allowed to shackle people behind their back. And the reason why being is because if I went to fall, I couldn't even catch myself. Hear me, I'm going somewhere. I'm not talking about the institution, y'all. I'm talking about, you know, you got your hands behind your back shackled and you can't even catch yourself. When we're tied up in the spirit, we're so vulnerable that we can't catch ourselves if we fall. And I believe that God is really intent on loosening some shackles in this season. Even though we're bound up and you feel like you're shackled in your house, God's going to loose some shackles right in your living room. He's going to loose some shackles right in your kitchen. He's going to loose some shackles in the bedroom closet, wherever your war room is. He's going to loose some shackles. He's not going to just loose your shackles. He's going to loose the shackles of your spouses, of your brothers, of your sisters, of your children, of your grandchildren. I declare that and I decree it right now in the name of Jesus. I believe that he is doing it. And we, you know, we're going to stay in Exodus for a minute just until everybody gets delivered, because we're not leaving anybody behind. If you're on this phone line and you walk out of this series still shackled, then that's your fault, because we want to hear from you. We want to pray with you. We want to pray those shackles off of you. There are times when we're anxious to help somebody else, and that's good, but how are you going to do that if yourself is entangled? You're tied up just as much as they are tied up. Our intentions may be good, but there are times when, ladies, you got to be selfish. I was teasing my husband last night, and we were talking about somebody, and not talking about him, talking about him, but we were talking about a situation, and I said, listen, baby, I said, you got to put the mask on your first self first before you put it on somebody else. And my husband jokingly said, oh, is that the Bible? I said, no, that's the airline statement that they make when you get on the airplane, but that's true. How are you going to fix somebody else when you're all jacked up? How are you going to untie somebody else when your hands are tied also? How do you pray for somebody else when you can't even pray for yourself? You don't even feel worthy enough to pray for yourself to say, God, help me. There's organizations like AA and NA, and they recommend that you get a sponsor. You get a sponsor when you're recovering. And again, I call it deliverance. I think we need a secret sister something, so that everybody got a sister that will call on you and check on you and pray with you and push you and make sure that you're accountable. An accountability partner, that's what we need. But we need something, again, that's going to help us get through this deliverance. A sponsor is someone that has been through what you've been through, and they were able to break free. Not only have they broken free of their addictions, but they continued to stay free. Listen, sometimes we've been broke free from addictions, but we go back to those same habits. We go back to those same hang-ups. We go back to those same addictions. I did that when I years ago when I was smoking cigarettes. I quit, and then before I knew it, I'd start back again. I'd quit and I'd start back again until God delivered me. He delivered me overnight. I'm talking to somebody. He delivered me overnight. So we need some sponsors. We need to assign sponsors even to new Christians, because they don't even know how to get back up after they fall. You can't go back and evangelize and help deliver someone from Jack Daniels and Brother Jim Beam if you're just now getting used to not drinking. Have you ever seen a 4-month-old baby trying to feed another and pamper another 4-month-old child? No, you have not. No, I need to be able to maintain my deliverance for a minute before going back into the fire to rescue someone else. And maybe that's why God kept Moses in the desert for 40 years, tending the sheep before he used him to go back into Egypt to deliver his people. 40 years he stayed in there. Don't you think he could have learned it in on-the-job training in 6 weeks? No, this took some time to do. So stop beating yourself up because you haven't gotten past that yet. It's been 3 years and you haven't gotten past that yet. It's been 5 years. You haven't gotten past that yet. You just keep getting up. You just keep trying. You just keep taking it to God. You just keep working on them shackles in the spirit. But Moses needed to get prepared and get some of his issues together. He just killed a man. When God's telling, I'm going in here and I don't want you to do none of that. I want to do the work. So you got to discipline yourself so you don't take God's position. And sometimes we as women, we like to take control because we're smarter. No, I'm just kidding. We like to take control because we think we know what is best. And sometimes God is saying, let me do it. I'm talking to somebody right now on this line. God's saying, let me do it this time. All your fussing and cussing and all that stuff didn't work. Let me, your father, do it for you. But he couldn't go back into Egypt the same way that he came out of Egypt. Some of us are just not meant to go back in Egypt. You ain't ready today, and you ain't never going to be ready. But nevertheless, what I loved about the Exodus is everybody participated, even their children. Nowadays, we allow children to make their own choices. Mm-hmm, we do. We allow them to choose whether they're going to church or not. We allow them to choose whether they're going to serve God or Buddha or Muhammad. We give them a choice whether they want to be a female or a male. We give them a choice of where they want to do this and where they want to do that. But the Bible clearly says to train the child in the way that they should go. You got to keep training them. And I know you've probably heard me say this before, but the word train in the Bible, when it talks about train up a child, it's like the train when you do a dog that keeps on messing on the carpet. You take the dog, you drag the dog to the urine, to the mess up, you stick their nose in it, you rub their noses in it every time they do it until they stop doing it. And sometimes our children didn't get the privilege of going all the way through training because we got too tired before they got trained. We got too frustrated before they got trained. But I declare, by golly, in this season, if I have anything to do with it, I'm not going to keep my mouth shut. I love our children too much to just be quiet about everything because we cannot allow any child to be left behind in this season. Listen, the COVID is taking our children out now. It was just taking out adults. First it started, it was old people. Then they thought it was all going to be Caucasian people. Then it started being a lot of predominantly African-American people with underlying situations going on in their health. But now they are taking kids out of here. Kids are dying. Kids are in the emergency room. Kids are in ICU. We got to go back and make sure that our kids get the same deliverance that we do. I will not leave no child behind. And we, as a group of women that meet on here every week, go back and get them. Go back and get them. Go back. Go get those grandbabies. Go get them nieces. Go get them little neighbors. Go get those godchildren. Go back. Oh my God, I feel it. Go back and get them. Say something. You got to learn how to say something to them, even if they don't speak to you for a week. Say something to them because we want them broken from bondage. We need them to be delivered from bondage. We don't lead them into bondage. We need to bring them out of bondage. Amen. I don't want to see anybody die and go to hell. I don't want to see anybody's child die and go to hell. So we got to get ourselves together so we can lead our children also out of, when they got ready to leave, listen, the children were with them. Later on, in the Old Testament when they're going through the wilderness experience and all of that. Listen, when the cloud moved by day and the fire moved by night, they packed up them tents and the kids got used to the routine. Hey, listen, when you see that, this is what we do. Start gathering up the food, start gathering up the pots and pans, start gathering up the sheep, start gathering up the goats, start gathering up your PlayStation, gather up your phone, gather up your cell phone, gather up, because we about to move. God's about to bust a move, and we got to prepare our children that they got to be ready to. Jesus is coming back, and I don't want none of my children left behind. Are you up to the task, ladies? Are you willing to sacrifice your lifestyle and bondages so that somebody in your family will make it to heaven like you? This is how I come. You remember back in when George Bush Jr. took office, and in first and second year, he went with the Department of Education to declare no child left behind. Well, it was a wonderful concept. They decided that our children's education here in the United States was on a consistent decline, and it came up with a solution that if we give schools an incentive by giving them federal funding, they would increase in learning. They wanted to give the children an incentive for not failing, and because they tried other things that did not work, money always seemed to be the answer. But I'm here to tell you that money is not the real answer. As a matter of fact, money is another controller, and it can bind you up worse than bad cheese can. The children continue to fail in this error. And how many here today know that we want our children, we don't want them to fail in high school. We don't want them to fail in college. How many of you want your grandchildren or your children or your daughter, your son to fail in life in general? Then how do you think the Father feels? The Father who's art in heaven, how does he feel about our failures? He doesn't want to see that none of us would fail. Not one of us would fall short. The Bible says that he would not like to see not one of us perish. In this season, ladies, we got to think for our children. We got to be aggressive. We have to be if you ain't got nothing to do, go sign up for the Boys and Girls Club. Go do something. Declare the works of the Lord. Tutor a child and put in there that Jesus loves them. This I know, for the Bible tells me so. We need to, we don't have VBS like we used to cause the pandemic, but we can do some things online and gather the children and have the parents make the children. No, you're gonna sit down and you're gonna watch this before you get to do that. My great niece and nephew had come to visit with their parents, and that was their anniversary. And so I sent the parents out to go eat at a dinner. I said, your kids will be okay with me. I know I'm old school, but it's gonna be all right. Well, they like pizza, Aunt Frida. So I ordered them pizza, and my nephew, who had fallen in love with this Oculus game that we had, when the pizza came, my little 2-year-old niece, she began to scarf it down like she ain't bigger than a minute. She was scarfing that down. But he was so focused on the Oculus game, even though he loved pizza, he loved the Oculus more. So I got a hold of that, and I said, listen, when you get up to that table and finish eating 2 pieces of that pizza, then and only then will I allow you to get back and play that Oculus game. Let me tell you, little man ran right up to that table, ate that pizza, looked at me with the great big smile and say, okay, Frida. And I let him go back. You got the upper hand here. Don't be frustrated. I know they say you can't beat your children. You better smack them legs. You better do something to keep them in front of the face of Jesus. Keep them in front of the face of Jesus. How would you feel knowing that your child died and went to hell, busted hell wide open at 16, 17, 18, when they got to the age of knowing? Because we never, never made them listen to who God was, listen to the word, listen to a hymn, listen to a worship song, listen to anything. We never made them do whatever, but they died and went and spent eternity in hell. What kind of good person would do that intentionally? Well, believe it or not, we do it. We do it because we don't think about leaving these children. We cannot leave one child behind. So until Jesus comes back, we got to go after them. We got to get them babies. We got to get them children. I appreciate you listening. I'm done. Thank you.
Amen.
No child.
Amen.
No child.
No child left alone.
You're not leaving them behind. No, you can't go to church. You run to church and leave your kids at home. Oh, come on now. No, y'all coming. All y'all coming with me.
Lord, have mercy. Lord, have mercy.
Yes, yes. Okay. Yes. Thank you so much. And we appreciate you.
Thank you. Yes, yes, yes.
Yes, sir. Amen. And
thank you. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Thank you. Love you. Love you. Love you. Yes.
You too.
Okay, we're going to go ahead. And Pastor Frieda, close to us, praying out and enjoying the hour, minister at the same time.
Amen.
Hey,
Lynette.
Lynette.
Yes, ma'am.
Did you get my text? I have four more names to give you.
Okay. Go ahead.
I got a text from Annie Jones. Her brother is in the hospital. She didn't give his name. Annie Jones' brother. And she gave me three other names. Johnny Caldwell. Presley Caldwell and Melvin Ritchie.
Okay.
Uh-huh. And that's it.
All right. Okay.
All right. Is that it? Okay. God, we thank you, Lord God. We thank you, Lord God. Even ahead of time, we're going to thank you for healing. We're going to thank you, Lord God, for deliverance ahead of time, God. Before we even ask you for anything, we're going to thank you for everything. Thank you, Lord God, for keeping us. Thank you for watching over us. Thank you for sending your word. Thank you for every praise report that has not been reported. Thank you for everything that you've done, Lord, things that you've completed on every list that we've sent out, Lord God, on Mondays and Tuesdays and throughout the week, Lord God. We thank you. We thank you, Lord God, for doing your part. We thank you, Lord, for being the main part. We thank you, Lord God, for paying attention to us. We thank you for paying attention to our concerns and to our needs and to our cries, oh God, just as you paid attention to the cries of the children in Israel, in Egypt, Lord God. I thank you. And so, Lord God, we pray, Lord God, first of all, before I forget, I want to pray, Lord God, for the people in New Orleans and Louisiana, Lord God. I just pray, God, for each and every hurricane victim, Lord God. We know what it is to be a victim, oh God, something taken from us, Lord God, that we didn't expect, Lord God, something taken from us and we couldn't help it. So I pray, Lord God, for all of those people who have lost people in the hurricane, those who have lost things in the hurricane, those that have no houses to stay in, Lord God, they don't have supplies, there's no electricity. Lord God, we ask that you bless quickly, 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 quickly help them recover. Lord God, in the name of Jesus, Lord God, we pray for the Afghanistan evacuees. God, in Jesus' name, Lord God, bring them out, bring them out. That today's the day, Lord God, bring them out with your mighty hand, just like you did the children of Israel. Lord God, do what you need to do. God, in the name of Jesus, Lord God, I'm so grateful, Lord God, for Brother Cyrus, Lord God, how you did the testimony, Lord God, with his COVID and how you raised his breathing level, that his lungs have began to expand. And so they're relaxing more, Lord God. So I thank you for doing that, oh God. We pray, Lord God, for the Warren family and the loss of their mother, God. There's nothing like a loss of a mother, Lord God. I can't imagine it, Lord God. We ask that you bless that entire family, whoever is attached to her, Lord God. We pray, God, that you heal them and that you comfort them. And Tynette, Lord God, who was admitted to the hospital, Send your word, oh God. Just send your word. Send ministering angels round about, Lord God. Send wise doctors and caring nurses, oh God, to take care of them. Lord God, we pray, Lord God, for old Cedric Miller II, Lord God. We pray for him, God, in the name of Jesus. What child, again, has lost their mother, has lost their mother, Lord God. We just ask that you send mothers, send many mothers to him, Lord God. Many mothers that will love him, Lord God, that he'll never feel like he's been abandoned. He'll never feel like he's been discarded. Oh God, that you'll send the love of a mother, that Lord God, we pray for the entire Thomas family, God, in the name of Jesus. We pray for Donald Reed, God, and COVID, and Catherine Marshall. We pray for Annie Jones, and for her brother, Lord God, in the hospital. Lord God, I whatever is going on with him, you only know, Lord Jesus, and you know how to fix it. So fix it, like the song said, like you said you would. God, we pray for Johnny Caldwell, Presley Caldwell, Melvin Ritchie, and anybody other names that I have forgot or didn't hear right, God. We ask that you cover all of them under the blood. We plead the blood over even the unspoken prayers, oh God, the ones that, oh, I'm tired of praying over that same thing. We ask for a repetitive, the repetitive prayers, Lord, that you cover the repetitive prayers, the pleading, Lord God, the pleading that goes on in the secret place, Lord God. We pray for them. We pray for every woman on this line, oh God, in whatever state that they're in, Lord, that they would be encouraged in this season, oh God. Keep them safe, Lord God. Keep them at peace. Keep them, give them joy, God, unspeakable joy, full of glory. And Lord God, we ask that you do all of these things. In the matchless name of Jesus, we promise to give you praise and the credit for it, God, because it all belongs to you. In Jesus' name, I pray. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. Amen.
Love you all.
Love you guys. Love you.